is sent to us to bring light into a darkened world. If today is your first time for attending St. Joseph's, we give you a very special welcome. We are privileged to use the Maronite ritual of the Catholic faith. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Thank you.
Father, and your Holy Spirit, forever. Amen.
So numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old. Or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb, no distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God. But he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words "it was reckoned to him" were read not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification.
Praise be to God always.
To make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know that this is so? For I am an old man, and my wife is getting on in years." The angel replied, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. But now, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will become mute, unable to speak, until the day these things occur." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at his delay in the sanctuary. When he did not come out, he could not speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He kept motioning to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. She said, "This is what the Lord has done for me, when he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I have endured among my people." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Because I think all of us
have something that can happen in our life where we make a decision whether or not to live out of the disappointment and the disfavor. That for some reason there's something about us or what other people are saying about us that we might want to discontinue being a part of, in this case, the temple. To not want to mix and worship and pray with people who can cause hurt and pain. But Zechariah didn't live out of, and Elizabeth did not live out of what they felt disgraced about, but what they had put their faith in. They continued to be faithful, and they continued to be loyal. Even in all the different ways, I'm sure they felt hurt. That's a reminder for me in my life that if I feel hurt, disappointed, which do I latch on to? Which do I begin to worship? My hurt, my pain, my disappointment, my resentment towards what others may have said? Or do I continue to worship the Heavenly Father? It's interesting that Zechariah was made mute, because it seems like, and we kind of make these decisions in different ways, that sometimes doing the right thing, being faithful, offering the incense in the temple, if God is going to bless us, then in this case, He's going to bless them with the child. I wonder if he ever thought, was it worth it to have to be embarrassed by now being mute, without being able to say anything? Why does a blessing seem to always have attached to it some kind of a setback or a burden? And that cannot be totally explained, because our need for redemption is a mystery. It's beyond our ability to comprehend it all. But even with that tension, in that conflict of being mute, God still was willing to work with him. I remember growing up a quote from St. Teresa of Avila. She was on her way to reform one of the convents, and it was thundering and raining, and she fell in the mud, and she was filthy and grimy. And she looked up to the heavens and said, "God, if this is how you treat your servants, maybe that's why you don't have very many of them." That's an honest question. And God never asks us to pretend we don't have the feelings that we have, and the struggles that we have, and the temptations and the turmoil. All He asks us is to see it through. Keep on following. That phrase, "the light will come in the morning," or peace, or comfort. Only thing is, as human beings, we don't want to wait. And that makes sense too. We were not created by the plan of God to wait for these things. We were not equipped to know how to handle death and hurt and pain, because we weren't created for that. It was never meant to happen to us. It wasn't His idea or His plan. His plan was that we would always dwell with Him in absolute perfect peace and harmony. Except that we have free will. We have the ability to make choices to make ourselves miserable and other people miserable. I can't imagine ever meeting anyone ever that has not experienced the hurt and the pain that they have made in their own decisions and in the decisions of others. That's the mess we're in. And we are still caught in it. But there is a way out. An angel has been sent. Two elderly couples, who was faithful, who did go through life knowing that people looked down upon them, but they worshiped and followed their faith rather than their pain. And so for them, they are going to have a child. It says in the prayers and it says in the scriptures, it's like a lamb. You know, one of the difficult things that I find as a priest is that the number of people who are in pain, who are struggling, who have been hurt, and therefore you're never going to see them in the temple again. Thinking that by running away is a solution. But if it's a solution, then why is hurt still controlling their life? Why is pain and sorrow their operative? Why, in a way, instead of being mute, they're very loud about their hurt and their pain? Some of it can be justified. We are and have fallen short of the glory of God. But who do you want God to send into the world? Light or darkness? Healing or more suffering? Forgiveness or being filled with all the emotions that come to us when we can't forgive? Who do you want? What do you want the angel to say to you and to me? What do you want to do about the mess that we are in? The fallen nature that we are? How do you want to deal with your wounds? Another angel is coming next week to bring to us the enlightened one.
Jesus, come, Lord Jesus.
and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon his offering of those who please God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, St. Mary, St. Joseph, and St. Jude. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those from whom this sacrifice is offered, for Brent and for Jordan. Remember also those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Oh, Salvia, ave, vahane, gaudia, domini. O caro, consolus igua, men pro, amen, magio.
Forgive them so that they may always live blameless lives in your presence and recognize that blessings that you bestow upon them. For you are good and rich in graces, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, civil leaders throughout the world, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all those who struggle with chronic illness, anxiety, and pain in their lives, that they will find healing and comfort in the Lord. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and a consecrated life to serve the Maronite Church. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who have pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charbel. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and your people. We truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember on this day all our veterans. May God richly bless them for the service and love that they show for our country and their unselfish care. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed, especially Brent and Jordan, who have left us and have gone to their rest, hoping in you, awaiting that life-giving voice, calling them to life. Accept the offering we present you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. For our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant rest to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be
Peace be with you.
partake and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, bless the faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in the divine mystery, in purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most High Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, great is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life.
vocations to the Maronite priesthood and religious life. May your prayers be heard, and may the vineyard be filled. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. There is a rosary sodality meeting after liturgy, and also this Tuesday, the 15th, at 6 p.m., there will be a general meeting that all are welcome to attend. Parish Council meeting will be in the hall, and everyone is invited to brainstorm for what we want to have as our next step forward in serving the church. So all are welcome. We thank you, Lord God, Father, and ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins, and the glory of your holy name, that of your only Son, and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, became flesh for our sake, and by sacrifice your Son, who saved us, deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name. For we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
And also I wish to thank you for all the prayers that were said and kind deeds that you did for a brother whose wife had passed away. The funeral went beautifully. Also keep my brother in your prayers. He's going to have surgery tomorrow. He has a twist in his intestines and needs to be corrected. So pretty hard on his children. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving of the Lord. May the blessing